OTAP community, it's me. We're back. First frequency of oneness, shock metaphysics. I am the metaphysical Morpheus, aka Shocktimus Prime, aka Shook Shock, Shook Shocker, Rev Shock, and all the shocking things that's going on in our all black world today. We're back. It's Thursday. That means that we are with a crazy, crazy elder that we absolutely love and adore. And that, of course, would be Dr. Clyde Winters. We just completed, family, a 15-week intense advanced research course with Dr. Winters, and just, we just want to give him his props, love him up today on the platform. And also, I have special guests with me today, and that is Reverend B-Man Billy Bird and Reverend High Priestess Ma'at M. Makaru Amen. Hotep fam, welcome.
Hotep.
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 Thank you. Thank you. So now let's go and talk about this experience that we underwent with Dr. Winters. And what was your Bill? I'll start with you, B-Man, because you were the first literally to sign up. And there's a story behind that. And the reason why you said something to the effect of you didn't want to miss this one. What did that mean to you?
No, I knew that this was a once in a lifetime opportunity. I recognized right off the bat that we were going to get the best training that we could possibly get as far as being an African-centric researcher. And Dr. Winters has been doing this for a long time. And so if you think about it, the training we got is the best of the best. It's all of his lessons learned and all of the different things that he has acquired along the way. And now he's sowing that into us with so much energy and enthusiasm. And so I have been following, and this is goes back to the what you want me to share about the background. I have been following Dr. Liala Africa for a long time. And rolling with him, I had an opportunity to get mentored by him and take a class that he was doing on holistic health. And I didn't take advantage of it. I was kind of nonchalant in the sense of, you know, I wanted to take it and I have frugal issues. And so, which really the training, just like this training, is priceless. You can't put a price tag on it, right? And so I fooled around and I didn't do it. And the last time I think I saw him was in Woodbridge, Virginia. And it wasn't soon after that that he passed away. And so missed opportunity. And I got to live with that. But I wasn't going to let this, you know, things happen for a reason. That happened for the reason to make sure that I didn't miss this opportunity. And I could tell the magnitude of this opportunity because it has literally changed my life. It has changed my perspective. It has changed my confidence. So it's so many levels to this thing that I could talk about. So, yeah, I wasn't going to miss this. And I certainly haven't been disappointed one bit.
Well, I just absolutely love that, B-Man. I love your journey. I love not only who you have become, I also love what you're becoming. I mean, we're all becoming. We're all in this Kepra together. It's absolutely amazing. And I think our special guest has arrived. And I'm going to come back to you, Queen Mother Ma'at. But we've got somebody, her arms are really tired. She had to do a lot of traveling, a lot of swimming and what have you. But she is back with us, Dr. Marie Charles. How are you, my goddess? I know your arms are tired. You dry off well. I know you're wet from all the swimming from one country to another continent and all of that. But here you are. And your hair looks great. You got it in a bun. I guess that's wonderful. So, you know, I know black people, black women and their hair, how that works. So I appreciate the travel.
Oh, you know it. You know all the secrets.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. And so we're going to love up on you today, Dr. Winters. I know you got a presentation to do, and Dr. Charles doesn't have a lot of time with us, but I asked her to just come on and talk about the impact that you've made in terms of research, because that's what all of this is about. And also we got Maquette, my aunt. Yo, what's up? What's happening, family? One of our great students. And this is just going to be so good. Why am I sounding like Bill Cosby right now? That's not good. Okay, so so my beloved Dr. Charles, give us your opinion about Dr. Clive Winter's level of research and why is it he so special to us? I know why, but why is he so special to you? To the work that you're doing in foundational Black British or Britons.
Hi, Dr. Winters. How are you?
Hey. Fine. How are you?
I'm good. No, Dr. Winters, whether he knows it or not, has so many keys to our history. His research is just phenomenal. Mm. And when you get into the depth of what Dr. Winters has shown the world in his books and his publications, you start to recognize and see yourself in his work. His work is just phenomenal. But I have to say, I'm really excited today because I had a paper accepted in an international peer-reviewed journal.
And wow.
What is so exciting? Thank you. What's so exciting about it is I feel as though I have another piece to the puzzle. I've been working on an artifact that I discovered that was found next to the body, and the body, the skeleton, is 33,000 years old. Now, ooh, this pendant that was found, I mapped out sacred triangles, and there were scalene triangles, right angles, and it's 33,000 years old and it's been accepted. So to me, it's another piece into the puzzle of those migrations unfolding across Eastern Europe, Southern Europe, and then the foundational Black Britons. So I feel very, very excited today.
That's incredible. That's incredible.
Oh my God.
But now, yes, Ashe, do you see the impact? This is what we're doing here. This is, you're impacting researchers around the world, Dr. Winters. So let me bring on High Priestess Queen Mother Ma'at M. Makaru. Amen. You took the class. We were back and forth, and some of us showed up, some of us didn't, but we got all the stuff that we needed to get, did we not? What was the class like for you, my beloved?
Oh, wow. So, yes, it was, you know, I have to say that I had to get pushed into it by a Rev Shock because I knew
what
my
mean? Study,
yes. No. Okay. It's all no. right. Now. It's okay. It's all
it
right.
I'm glad you did. No,
I'm glad you did, though. I'm really glad you did, because I knew what my schedule was going to look like. And so it would be challenging. However, I cannot replace, even though I call myself on the short yellow bus with the class, right? I can't replace what I learned, because as you know, I write books, right? And so I am in the process of finishing up another book. And I was looking up testosterone levels. By what they say, you know, because they always break everything by race, right? And it was amazing because they say if you look it up, they'll say they have one with that puts every race, every cultural group having the highest testosterone level. Okay, so you know, they say the Chinese do. They say the Mexicans do. They say, you know, and I was like, really? Like, that's not what I heard a long time ago. But I looked at the type of research that they did, the type of study. And when I saw how they did it, I said, oh, that's what he was talking
that's
about.
That's what Dr. Winters was teaching us, yes.
You can make anything.
It had to be Bayesian, right?
It was Bayesian. There was the one that I found that had the real data, that had Africans at the top.
Right.
Because I was looking at testosterone levels for male and female. Okay. Mm-hmm, and estrogen levels, because this is part of what I'm doing, right? And so that one had the with the chai test. Is that the right one? And so I was like, oh my God, like I actually learned something, like I remember that. And so, and then I have to say, Dr. Charles, one of the first articles that we researched was yours.
Yes.
We did your article. And when I read it, I said, whoa, her stuff is so
on point. I don't know where she came from. Dr. Charles is, she's in another world, man. I tell you.
I am.
And I said,
she said, yeah, I am. At least you know.
I was like, where is she doing this study on children? Because I need to get my children in her program.
No question.
You know what I mean? So it was, so I did, you know, and I, and Dr. Winters, he said this. He said, even if you, you know, y'all like my aunt and y'all be in class sometime and not all the time. He didn't say that. He was looking at me though when he said it.
He was looking at me. Mm-hmm. Yep.
He said, yep. I guarantee you're never going to look at statistics or research the same way again. You already are far ahead of where you're, and that's exactly the experience that I had. So it was phenomenal. I recommend anybody, you got to go through this process so you know what you're looking at. Because if you Google things, everybody Googles, right?
Right, right.
And so sometimes that first thing that comes up is not, you got to look at how they did it. And if you don't know,
if you don't know, you're thinking that's fact.
Yep.
That's right. Right.
Yeah.
That's
so that was right. my experience. I give thanks. That's a great piece. I give thanks.
Thank you, Goddess. Thank you for that. Well, now let's bring on Baquet Maet, who's up there looking like Shaka Khan. Shaka Khan. What's going on, Shaka? How you be? She has her hair down. You saw her hair down. Is she up there looking
You're on your A game today, aren't you?
I am on my A game today. What am I not though, right? What's going on? I mean, Baquet. What's going on, Goddess? We can't hear you. Your mic is off. Uh-oh. Is she singing? No, I'm just messing with you. No, I can't hear you, Goddess. Turn your mic on.
So now you're going to make me say, I feel for you.
Exactly. Exactly. Show some papillon. I mean, just come on. We can just go, you know, tell me something good. That's all I'm saying.
Oh, this can't be happening.
Come on, Baquet. We can't have you not the sound. I hope it ain't on my end.
Does that usually happen to me?
No, I don't. Yeah. I can't hear either. She's going in slow motion.
She may have to go in slow motion.
Shaka Khan. She does remove it. She moves in slow motion. But, oh, Baquet. Poor thing. She's like, what's going on? We can't hear you. I know. I've been having so much tech problems this week, man. It's been absolutely insane. And then it was actually been a crescendo, a buildup, because even with you, Dr. Charles, remember your machine was revving up. I think your fan or your what do you call it, the power thing was going out or whatever. I don't know if you got that rectified or not, but that was absolutely insane. And it only happened when you were talking about certain things. Like it was so calculated, it's so crazy. So I've just learned to just deal with it and just work through those energies and frequencies, because they do happen. Mm-hmm. Frequency does happen. All right, so we're gonna wait for Baquet to come back, but as we do so, Dr. Winters, what do you have to say about all this love that we have for you?
Well, listen, you're nicer today than on Monday. You guys surprised the hell out of me. Dr. Charles, what's the name of your article? If you can tell it now,
it's called Decolonizing. It's Decolonizing the Curriculum.
Can we hear you?
I think it's Baquet causing an echo now.
I've now got a feedback.
Yeah,
and we still can't hear her, which I don't know why. And now it's you're right. Feedback over the feedback. Family, this is what happens when you try to. FM, do this stuff. They coming at me, boy. Let's bump you off here and see what happens here. Try to come go off and come back.
Burkett, I'm gonna have let's bump you off here
and see if my and see if we can lose this echo. Now my damn Siri is trying to come. This is crazy. All right.
So can you hear me? Go ahead, Charles. I think you're fine now.
Okay.
So it is decolonizing the curriculum, colon, who were the ancient Europeans?
Ah, okay. It sounds interesting. I can't wait to read it.
I'm just so thrilled, I cannot tell you, because a lot, and of course you feature on the first page, Dr. Winters.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
And I think now I'm beginning to realize the power of presenting our material culture. Once we start to show our evidence in our research papers, it becomes irrefutable. And the sheer abundance of it in a connected narrative, and you know, it's undeniable. Once you start to show all of the patterns and the culture and the connections.
What would be of this, Dr. Charles, if you could, for the community, for the family at large, who might be hearing this some of this for the first time? Why is it so important to do one primary research and particularly to try to get the information peer reviewed? What does that do for the community at large and for the entire social science, anthropology, archaeology, Africana phenomenology group? Mm-hmm. What does it do for that? For us as a group of people trying to learn our history and figure this out?
Well, it's a simple statement, but it's quite profound. We're making power moves. We take control of our narrative.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, we step forward and we say, using first sight consciousness, this is how it happened. A lot of the information, as many of your panel know, particularly Dr. Winters, a lot of material is suppressed.
Mm-hmm.
It's hidden, concealed, and distorted. Mm-hmm. We step in and we say, no, this is how it really happened. Of course, we're very scholarly in our approach. We show in our arguments and our discursiveness how it really happened.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we have to, as you mentioned before, Lady Ma'at said that, you know, when we're doing our research, not everything is Googleable. We have to get into the discipline of studying hard and reading hard. I mean, if you could see my library, I've invested a lot of money in a library, but it's serving me so well. I can go to that section. I can go to my anthropological section. I can go to my linguistic section. I can go to the history section, which Dr. Winters features a lot in every section. But yeah, we do. We have to be very, very disciplined. And we have to read.
But then also, it's very important also to take that step. A lot of people don't understand is that, you know, a lot of Euronuts, they get mad at me because they say, how can an Afrocentric scholar get some articles published in peer-reviewed journals?
Mm-hmm.
All you do is send it out. They're going to either say yes or no.
Mm-hmm.
Say yes or no. And sometimes they'll tell you how to make the article better and send it back.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
See, but a lot of people don't understand is that's all it is. It's taking a chance and sharing the knowledge.
Mm-hmm. But it's also learning the process and format.
Right.
That's what's most important.
Right, because at least four of my students, they've written some super papers already. Mm-hmm. And I've asked them if they'll maybe send it out to maybe certain journals and see what happens. You know, mm-hmm. you never know. Mm-hmm. You never know. And all they can do is say no, but that yes that one yes is a mother, right? Right,
that's
Dr.
right.
No, oh, there's no other feeling. You just feel so legitimized within the field. And it's very, very powerful. Yeah. But what do they say? There's that old adage, isn't it, when they say, if you want to hide anything, put it in a book.
Yeah. Right.
People right. don't read. Exactly. People just don't read. But also, just to add what Dr. Winter said as well, we have to keep pushing the boundaries, and the research has to be original. Because a lot of these editors with these journal publications, they get a lot of the same stuff. If you can come in with an edge, something that's original, then that's going to set you apart from the 500 submissions that they receive every year. So I would always say to researchers, try to think of something or that you've come across that is original. And that would add to the field in terms of new knowledge. We're always looking for new knowledge. It's very, very critical.
Phenomenal. Thank you for that, Goddess. Go ahead, B-Man.
If I could add on to Hotep, to Dr. Marie Charles, when we had to read your paper, and reading the paper gave me a little more in-depth into the process. And then as I listened to you talking today, we have to read, but I also hear your voice saying the next level is comprehension, right? When we read,
we have
to comprehend what we read and then dissect it and then pull the things out that people don't see, like the triangles, you know, the things that are right in front of you, but you just miss them. And so I definitely...
Is that what you call first sight consciousness?
Absolutely. I just... And I also have your book as well, B-Man, which...
Oh, my gosh. Thank you.
Now, you done messed up now. Now, I cannot... He was uncontrollable before.
Oh, my gosh.
We've got to go Jurassic Park and lock this dude up. I don't know what will be able to contain him now. Because Dr. Charles said your book. That's it. All right, he's done. He's done. Okay. We're not having technical difficulties. Billy is gone.
It's all part of that psychological grounding, which is very important. But just going back to that to that first sight consciousness, I found a picture that's been on my wall, and it's been up about 3 years, and I got my magnifying glass out. And it's a stone from South Africa, and there's a face that has been etched in the stone. It's about 20,000 years old, and the profile of the face it matches an artifact that I'm working on now, which is Scotland. I'm working on ancient Scotland and Northern Britain, the FBBs, and it's exactly the same face. Now, those are the types of things that we are detectives. We have to become detectives and search out these hidden artifacts and the hidden clues, because our ancestors, they left everything for us to rediscover and unearth and present to the next generation.
Yes. Yes. And something you also say, Goddess, and then I'm going to come to you, Bouquet. And that is, we need to put our hands on the material, and we need to have our hands on the artifacts, and we need to have our interpretation, because they are not qualified. In fact, it's a violation to exhume someone else's artifacts and take it, steal it, put it into a museum and profit from it. So we need to take that back. And this is what this looks like in terms of doing high level, what you call first sight consciousness research. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate that.
But it also takes grounding. And I think that's very important. It takes grounding. I couldn't do the research I did without knowing about, Dungy, without knowing about Du Bois, without knowing about Jay Rogers. Mm-hmm. You still had to have some grounding so you can have that insight to maybe see something. But again, God is great. And I know some people get mad at me when I say this, but like I always tell, Irvin, sometimes you can look at a picture for years and don't see what it means. And then all of a sudden God will say, oh, there's something there. See, there's a message in everything. And sometimes knowledge is right in front of your face, but it's not the right time. The mm-hmm. time is so important.
That's very, very profound. That's so heavy. Okay. Absolutely. And that's why we come to this research every day. Every day, I discover something every day. And if I don't find something, then it hasn't been a very good day. But that's the type of energy and commitment and belief that we have in the research. Mm-hmm. Because our history is just wonderful. Our history is wonderful. Mm-hmm. And when we activate that first sight consciousness, we will find something every single day.
I love that. All right, Shaka Khan. I mean, Bukette, let's come on in here now. I think we can hear
you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yay.
I think I love you.
I came on just in time to hear Queen Sister Charles say, you know, you've got to get the do right. You've got to bring the antenna in order to connect. I agree
So live from wherever she's at, family, this is Shaka Khan, Bukette. So Bukette is one of our research students.
Grateful.
Which is research student. And she just kind of zipped to the top of the class because she also does English. She's an English lit guru. And she was just invaluable. And we created this little study group. And Dr. Winters can talk about the power of a study group studying together as opposed to individually. But Bukette, please share your journey coming to this and how you found out about it and what it's done for you. You said something interesting about you used to just sit up and post on Facebook or one of those social media platforms. Walk us through your story.
Everything that everybody said, I 100%. The first sight consciousness, having access to first sight consciousness. Prior to this, I was that person that would sit for 3 hours to comment on a Facebook post or an article, and put in footnotes and a bibliography and reference to this, that, and the other, because there is a passion. And because, you know, like Queen Sister Charles said, I have information and I know better, and our history is phenomenal. And to watch it be cheapened and the agenda that's behind it, it would bring fire. I would feel a way about it. So I would sit and comment and then erase it all. Because I'm not trying to expose myself as any kind of extremist or anything else. But now having the format, having the process, the practice, the methodology to deliver that information and to bring that same fire and that same passion, but to do it in a bulletproof mode. Like, I know what I know. I know what I'm talking about. And I have, you know, sources. I've got a minimum of 2 sources for whatever I'm saying. I'm not just making it up or coming out of nowhere with it. And to Baba, for that aspect of it, it has changed my life, because something happens when you have that inside of you, but you don't have a way to deliver it. You don't have a way to get that voice out. And what I recognize and have always recognized in other aspects of my life, the game is designed to ensure failure. So when that happens, you change the rules of engagement. But when you're dealing with scholarship, how do you do that? It's a merit-based system. You don't have letters behind your name. You're not credible. What you have to say doesn't matter. And you don't know the language. This is the gift. This is the blessing that Baba has given me, is that now I have not only the first frequency gift, but I have that first sight consciousness ability to own the rules of engagement, to deliver what I need to say and to have it be credible and to be able to stand up to scrutiny. If you ask me how I acquired this scholarship, I can tell you. If you ask me how I defend this scholarship, I can tell you. So it's a level of confidence, and something else that the Queen Sister said, the discipline, that has been a gift. Getting up every day, I give myself 3 hours to spend on these projects and these things that I've always wanted to bring to fruition. and to take the time to, you know, download and read another article, make my little note cards for it and file it away, because I know it's going to feed back into, you know, the letter I want to write to Harvard about their apology, the letter I want to write to the American Psychiatrist Association about their apology. I'm gathering that data and I'm gathering those studies. And like Lady Ma'at said, I can look at the way these studies were conducted, and I can make choices about what is credible to me and what I want to use to back up my voice. Mm-hmm. So it's a gift all the way around, because it's placed me squarely in alignment with my purpose and what Creator has had for me on my heart for so long. And I just couldn't breach that distance. And I knew if I just hang on to Rev's coattails, just stick with Rev, just stay there. He kept bringing me that scholarship. He kept bringing me closer to it. He kept bringing me methodology. You kept bringing me, you know, on that journey through the pre-disturbance, the disturbance, all the way to the revolutionary consciousness that says, you know, I have something that is significant. My explicit experience, I have something to offer. I have something to contribute to those that come behind me. And I have the ability to frame my own narrative. So I'm going to do it. The confidence. But I am forever grateful to you, Baba, for how you have ordered my life and placed me in cycle for my highest frequency. So Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe.
That is so awesome.
Isn't it?
Yes.
Dr. Winters, let me ask you this. When you've obviously taught so many classes, you interface with thousands and thousands of students around the world. How does this feel to you, this particular one? How does this feel? Is this a little different than what you were used to in university when you were teaching?
Well, this was much different because I had to extend it. I usually just taught how to do general social science research, mainly focused on education, but I had to try to teach my students how to do linguistic, how to do anthropological, how to do sociological. It's like I had to teach them how to read all the different types of literature. You know, you're in the class, so I had to do something different. And also I felt a lot of pressure, and I felt pressure because the fact is that I had told you guys I was gonna make you giants, and I felt pressure that I wanted to make sure that I kept that promise. It put extra pressure on me to try to make sure that you guys could understand the research process, how to write up your papers and how to get things out, statistics and everything. And so then on Monday, you guys made me feel so good, you know, in the sense that it made me feel that I accomplished my goal. Not only did I help you to become giants, you're going to be bosses. And see, that's what Dr. Childs is talking about, being a boss. She's being a boss in prehistorical studies, because she's saying stuff from the perspective of somebody that knows what she's talking about. Mm-hmm. See, this is something that many, the majority of Black intellectuals, they don't really talk with authority unless they're talking about the Bible, unless they're sort of a church scholar. They don't never really talk with an authoritative, you know, feel based upon really believing in themselves and the knowledge that they're producing. But see, when you see a sister like you know, Dr. Childs, and what some of you guys are going to do, you know, it has made me feel so good. You know, you guys don't know it, but Kat is writing a paper. You know, if you can see some of the stuff on our basic research, she hasn't even really, you know, talked to as many people as she's going to put in her study. But if you can see, if you can see it. And one day, if God wills, and we can get the people out of the nerve, one show, the people are going to present some of their paper, let you see the type of research that they've done. And I'm so excited because the fact is that some of the guys have written at least some papers that I've asked them to submit them to journals and see what happens, because it's just that good and just that unique, that uniqueness. And it's very interesting. And see, this is the whole point, as Dr. Childs said, you want to, in a sense, seek to publish articles that, that have a little bit different from what people are reading every day, because editors get the same stuff every day.
That was great intel.
That's what they've been taught at university. So they regurgitate, as you would say, Dr. Matthews, they regurgitate what they've already heard, but that regurgitation isn't going to get your work published. It's that's something different. That's something different that they can say, maybe people will be interested in this. Mm-hmm. They're always looking for that. You know, and I started publishing articles as soon as I got out of university. I got my BA and master's in 4 years. And so I just started publishing articles. And people used to call me back in the 70s, Dr. Winters. I didn't have my PhD. Mm-hmm. They just couldn't believe that somebody would be sending them articles unless they had a PhD. And I've been publishing articles ever since 75. And I've been very lucky, because I would study a journal, see what they wanted, and then send it out. And you know, it's so exciting. And see, some of you guys are going to feel what Dr. Childs feels. And Dr. Childs know what I mean is that Dr. Childs has written an article. She's written two articles that I know of. She's written two articles, books, and her InFit is her InFit is such a beautiful magazine. Mm.
Your book finally came too, Doc. I have it. So it's over there. I can't get it right now because of the camera, but I got it. Yay.
But see, when you write stuff, just to know that there's hundreds, thousands of people are going to read your work that you're never going to meet, but you're going to have influenced them to make them see the world in a different light. And that's what it's about. It's about changing the worldview of people out there. And see, I'm so excited because the fact is that the Dirty 30, as you guys call yourself, you guys are going to make such a great... There it is. Throw that sign up.
Wait a minute. Are we crip stepping? What are we doing now? What's going on in a different direction? This is the first frequency of oneness shock metaphysics here. This is, no, I'm just kidding. Go ahead.
But again, like I said, is that you guys, y'all made me feel so humble on Monday. And you guys always, you know, make me want to cry, but I'll let Reverend Matthews do that. But
that's just so wrong on so many levels right there. You know, this is what happens when people become family. They just feel like they could just out you to the entire universe right there. That's just wrong. Yeah, I'm a crybaby in the family. I know it. Yeah, okay.
But it's good tears. And
it's tears of love and joy.
Like on Monday, some of the people had the nerve, they presented their papers. There's so many just good papers. I wish you guys could have been at our meeting on Monday. They did beautiful slideshows. Someone was supposed to present today, but they became afraid. Corey did a very beautiful elevation.
Corey was amazing.
It was just very wonderful. And
so was Magina. Magina or Janine, she was amazing. Aisha, Deborah,
Matthew,
Pilgrim. Was phenomenal. So everybody came through. Now, they're a little scared to be on the show live. William, I can understand too. That. William Starks. Well, William is out there in the audience now, but he's trying to be scared.
What Starks did is that he not
and James wrote, Irving. Don't forget James.
Oh yeah, James. But what I liked about William is that he wrote not only a good paper, but even shared with us his artwork and his And James. You know, Irving, that guy, he's about to take some time off.
Yes.
he's about to write something that's going to blow your mind, your mind. And, you know, and there's so many people in the class that I know that I'm going to be reading you guys' work for years. You know, hopefully I'm going to see a lot. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. We got 30 new bold researchers. Because see, it's a lot of foundational Black American and African and Caribbean PhDs. They're afraidy cats. Mm. They're afraid to go out on a limb. Look at what Dr. Childs did. Dr. Childs wrote an article on prehistory and dared to send it out there and let her peers look at it. And they said, hey, you know what? This is super, super.
Talk to us about that, Dr. Charles. Why do you believe, now we know Dr. Winter's reasoning because he has shared that with us of previous classes, but share with us your idea or understanding why more doctors don't publish. Why do you think that is?
You mean in terms of this subject, our history, recovering our stolen history?
Or just, yeah, like Doctor said, he just period. Why do they get and they don't write? They don't write articles. They don't publish. Why do you think that is?
Well,
or is that something that happens in your area?
Well, I think I have to say it's very costly for them in terms of their careers and their reputations and the roles that they occupy, because they're usually attached to a university. So when they start to operate outside those parameters of the status quo history, there's usually a knock on the door that says, should you really be writing about this? Mm. You know, they get those little warnings that they're veering off into dangerous ground. But I just wanted to pick up on what Dr. Winter said about his group teaching, because I'm a pedagogist. That's my foundation. My foundation is teaching and learning within the classroom with young children. Mm-hmm. So with that article that you analyzed, you'll see this dialogic mapping throughout the paper. And I was interested in when you said that you had your groups, because you felt it was very powerful to have the groups interacting and talking, because mm-hmm. that's an area that I have written about, because I've written with a colleague of mine
mm-hmm.
on that very subject, and he's a master pedagogist. So it's the dialogic interplay that I'm very interested in, and the zone of proximal development, because when you're working in a group, other people start to tap that zone mm-hmm. that would lay dormant if that group were not activating it. And Dr. Winters was talking about that before. Did you do a lot of that in your study groups?
Yeah, well, we got together an hour, sometimes 2 hours before the actual class on Monday, and just start melding our minds together.
Mm-hmm.
And it was magical. It was just magical. I had never experienced anything like that, because
it's very powerful.
It is. I'm you know, my trauma has pushed me to become a solopreneur, which is why I've mastered the internet, why I don't have to leave the house. I don't have to interact with humans. and so being in a group, that's new to me, if you can believe it. And it was absolutely magical, because we all had something to contribute. Mm-hmm. And by that contribution, all of us just went to a completely different level that we could not do individually. It was quite amazing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Quite amazing. I mean, I don't know, Billy or Maquette, you guys were part of the team. You guys want to share some of your research group studies aha moments with the community and with Dr. Charles and Dr. Winters?
I'll let.
Well, it was the same for me. It was. Oh, go ahead, baby. My bad.
No, I wanted you to go first, because.
It was the same for me. It raised the effort to a higher level. It was the synergy for everybody bringing their piece and creating a whole knowledge. Or a whole method of knowledge creation. It was magical. And one of the things when I was listening to Baba speak that I was just reminded of, as a teacher, part of my pedagogical understanding was good teachers create teachers. And that was the experience with Baba. Not only that, but good leaders create leaders. So So that was one of the experiences that came not only from the class, but also in the group dynamic of being raised higher, having my effort raised higher, having the discipline raised higher, getting questions from different directions and different perspectives of what I wanted to focus on or what I was trying to say and whether or not it had gotten across. And just the first frequency ascension, it's magic. I go with magic. Black magic.
I like to get magic for 200, Alex.
See, they suppress that methodology in the classroom. They don't like that takes your thinking onto higher levels of ascension, and it unearths what is hidden and is lying almost dormant, but is a latent aspect within you. And these teachers do not encourage that because A, some of them are not really that equipped methodologically or in terms to do that in the classroom, but it's hard work because you have to plan. We call them guided group teaching, and I have written a paper on that, but you have to plan for it pedagogically. It doesn't just happen because you have to know when to listen, what to listen for, the type of questions to pose, and the type of thinking that it will bring about. So it's a very, very higher order aspect to your learning.
Love that.
And the education system.
But to go back to the,
encourage that.
To go back to the leader thing is that the type of leaders that I like is that what I liked about you guys is that you're leaders, but you're not the traditional black leader. What I mean by traditional black leader, the traditional black leader is an individualist. You know, he's got to make sure that his church is the best, his paper is the best. And what I liked about you guys is that you guys saw leadership as a fusion. In other words, bringing leaders together, and then you guys work out a plan, and then you work together. And see, that's what B1 is all about. B1 is recognizing that you can share. You know, you can share in the promotion of knowledge. And that's what I liked about you guys. I used to get, I'll tell you, family, I wasn't there in case they would say something negative about me. I don't want to hear it. But anyway, I wanted them to have their own group, and they could develop their own means. Because see, a lot of good stuff came out of that. For the family out there, a lot of people who came into the program, they have a lot of good ideas. They have so much evidence. The one good thing that I liked about the class is that I think I was able to get people to start to think about putting their knowledge into fragments. I'll be honest. As educational psychologist, I am a Vygotsky. I like the Vygotsky idea that peers teaching peers. The younger teach the younger can teach the youngest. The oldest can teach the youngest. I like Vygotsky. But the point is this, though, is that what I liked about you guys is that you guys were developing a fusion leadership. Leadership in a sense where everybody has the confidence to discuss what they're good in, but not be ready to kind of ignore or make other people feel that they're not as worthy. And that's all I like about you guys is that you guys develop an idea among yourselves is that everybody's worthy. You should speak just as much as I should speak. And I love that about you guys developing that type of fusion leadership.
Fantastic. Thank you for that, Dr. Winters. B-Man, you had something you wanted to contribute?
Yeah, I was just going to say a couple things is when you have a high power group, the one thing we had to do is because you all bosses, right? So you have strong personalities. And so everybody got to kind of drop their personality at the door a little bit and recognize. Yeah,
remember that the next meeting after Dr. Charles says she's reading your book. Remember that this is being recorded, you know.
As the immortal Dr. Winters said, it's always your fault.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. There it is. I don't get a break, Doc. Dr. Charles, you need to come save me. Pray for me.
But the point being that we learned a lot from each other. We also learned who had certain skills and core strengths that now we can rely on to help us be better. So it's a really an iron sharpened an iron situation where everybody came out better. And so for me, I love that part of it. It didn't feel like everybody was pulling their weight. You know, that's the other thing about when you have groups like that, you have to really, everybody got to really pitch in, you know, and so it worked out well. The other thing that I want to add is Dr. Charles talked about the importance of having financing. Well, Dr. Winters also taught us about grant writing, and he didn't mention that. And so that's another avenue to be able to finance our work and push ourselves forward. And so the class was just so comprehensive on so many levels that I just, you know, I'm speechless when it comes to when I realize what we really got and what the future really looks like for us as well.
I just wanted to say something about the group. The group part, because especially when Dr. Charles was breaking that down, I was thinking, wow, you know, this concept, and I'm sorry, that's my phone in the background. I forgot to mute it. Today. That this
You've got a slight model, echo, so I don't know if you guys want to mute yourselves while we're talking, because we got that did it. Somebody did it. Okay, go ahead.
I was saying that, I think that model, I was going to ask the question, but Dr. Winters kind of answered it, but It made me think about where we are as a, you know, Black community. And how come I was just having these conversations this past week about, you know, there are so many people out here in the United States, and I'm sure it's the same way. I thought I shut it down. There are people.
Tell that man you're going to call him back, okay? You don't need to be all your business out in the street. I know he, because he know where you at. He's, oh, she on the show now. I know how to get her. That's
you what can't ask him so why you on the said. Show? You know? Okay. Anyway. Are you talking to him?
We family, fam. This is what we do.
Okay. But so what I was saying is, so, you know, we have so many Black people out here. They have farmland. They got 100. We hear about all these people. They got 100 acres of this. They have, you know, these people have this all across the United States. And I'm pretty sure it's like that across the world. And the question I ask is, how come we have all of these people and everybody's doing it solo, that the people can't come together? We can't find a way to come together. And so perhaps this model that came out of this class, like Dr. Winters is the GOAT, man, I'm telling you, because this model could be something that is developed that could be used to kind of join these groups together, mm-hmm. because everybody wants the same thing. Everybody mm-hmm. wants to have land that we can live on, or all of these different spots and do our own farming and all of these things that we talk about, but everyone's doing it solo, can never get people to stick around long enough to have it go through completion or whatever, because everybody wants to be in charge. And it, you know, with this, I know I wasn't in participation like that, but what it sounds like is that this is the model that perhaps could be used or presented in some kind of way, if it was blown out and developed, that could be presented to start merging those gaps that we have.
I like that.
No, so that's what that's I heard genius. when I was listening to it.
Wow.
Can I add something to that? I recognize, I believe Lady Ma'at is absolutely correct, but while she was talking, it occurred to me that, you know, for me personally, this has been a journey to get to the place where I could participate in a group with other leaders and let it be about principles over personality. That was that first frequency journey. So it was very much a process for me personally, somebody with a strong personality, to get to the point where it was about knowledge creation. It wasn't about the personalities. It wasn't about the hierarchy. It wasn't about, you know, who's going to be heard and who's going to be in charge. So I absolutely agree that the methodology could definitely be brought forward, but it also needs that piece of the process and the journey to be able to maintain that level of collaboration for a high principle and put the personality on the back burner. But that was my experience, and I'm grateful. That's how I knew I was in the right place at the right time, because it took that journey to get to the place where I could be in that company and raise the vibration and be part of a first frequency or first size consciousness principle. But I absolutely agree.
Ashe. And I know Dr. Charles is going to have to leave in a moment, but what I'd like, Billy, if you could, and I know Dr. Winters is going to be doing a presentation as well. Billy, do you have the certificate that you could possibly share that we can show the community and for Dr. Winters? Let me know when you have that in the chat, or not in the chat, in the green room. So you have to, I'm not sure how you, I think you have to share your whole screen and then find it, find the tab or open it up somehow. If not, we'll just talk through it.
Can you see it?
Nope, it hasn't come in yet.
Okay. Yeah, it looks like it's not going to play nice for me.
Okay.
It's telling me I got to go into my security and all that on my...
Oh, my gosh. Okay. All right. Well, so what we designed, we presented to Dr. Winters Monday night is a certificate from First Frequency of Oneness, Shock Metaphysics, signed by myself and Reverend B-Man. Just to acknowledge that this was the first of its kind. It was one of the most unique experiences that I've had. It took me academically to a completely different level. And I had just, like the week before that or whatever, I had just completed my doctorate, and I was upset because I wanted to do this class because I would have had to rewrite my whole dissertation. It would have been a completely different thing. It would have been really on fleek. But I just want to honor you and acknowledge you, Dr. Winters, and that you have empowered 30 lives. You have changed 30 lives. You have, in a very real sense, like the old $6 million man, you've made us better than we were before, faster and stronger. And I feel like running in slow motion right now, you know? We just all, on behalf of all of us in the class, and also Dr. Marie Charles, who we just adore and love and honor her for just being able to take the time out to be here tonight, because I think it's like 9-10 o'clock her time, and she just had a full day of research, if you know Dr. Charles. So she's got to get back, get that beauty sleep so she can keep that research on fleek. But we just want to collectively say, Ashe, Ashe, oh, we love you, Dr. Clyde Winters. We see you, we support you, and we honor you.
Ashe.
You know, just before I go, just as you were please, talking there, Dr. Winters, it seems to me, has created the blueprint, a prototype of how we proceed forward to regain who we are and to change the paradigm. He has created a blueprint and the prototype for moving forward. That's what I'm picking up, and I had no idea what his classes were like. But if it's anything like his books.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Very special.
You know, Billy and I, we frequently talk about how people were when they first met Ben Yacaman or first met Dr. Clark back in the day, and the legacies that they left behind
and we look at Dr. Winters and we say, you know, there's going to come a point where we say, where were you when Dr. Clyde Winters taught you how to write, how to research, how to see content through a first sight consciousness? Where were you? What were you doing? Who were you with? It's one of those moments that creates a new level of history. And you're absolutely right, beloved. This is a blueprint. I like that language and frame, because that's what this is. You're never the same again, and you're so better for it. And you just want to make sure that you make Dr. Charles and Dr. Winters look good, because that's the legacy in which you're coming from. B-Man, you wanted to chime in on that, because I know you and I, we just talked about it, I think, the other day, just yesterday.
Yeah, it's, you know, when you take it to the level we take it to, we taking this really serious.
Right.
And with it comes that pressure, you know. I don't want to present anything or put anything out there that isn't representative of Dr. Winters. You know, and I'm at that point, you know, I'm so happy for Dr. Charles with getting her paper, and I'm being pushed by someone in this chat that is telling me to present, you know, to present my paper and submit my paper. So for me, I'm just at the level that I'm just happy to submit something. So, I'm just kind of just looking at it as a new beginning, and I can't wait to see what's going to happen as I continue to just sharpen and hone my skills. And I'm looking forward to, again, collaborating with folks, because I think the collaboration piece is what continues to hold us back, because we know that if we're all working together with the same cause, we can't be stopped.
That's right. That's right.
It's when we are by ourselves that they can attack one of us, and then we, you know, then we're weaker. But it's hard to attack a whole group of us, because I know Dr. Winters will start swinging on somebody.
No question about it. What do you say? You say, I got you for about 20 seconds, and then after that, just pick me up and make sure I get home safely.
You got that right.
And I'm worse than that. I probably only got 5 or 10 seconds. So anyway, and Dr. Charles, I appreciate you for being with us.
Thank you.
Stick around and hang around. You can, but I know you got to go, Goddess. But I want to make this last point also about this class and what was unique about it, and I don't think we talk about this enough. Doc is able to teach advanced research, whether you're 8 or 80, because we had 80-year-olds in the class. We had elders in the class. We had 30-year-old people in the class. We had everybody and everything in between. And I think that's really important, because we think that you have to be of a certain age. You have to be of a certain level of economics or a certain level of academia. No, come as you are. And if I, you know, isn't that the doctrine that we all want to speak? Is that no matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter what you have done or what has been done to you, we can grow you. Dr. Winters can grow you beyond your current state. And you're never too old, because I think for me also, what was so amazing about James Irving and Brother William Starks, these were the elders in our group. They're geniuses, and they're walking encyclopedias. They to be able to then learn how to express and emote all of that genius now through this process of research. And what they brought to the table, man, I cry all the time, but I got a little emotional, because it was just beautiful to see. You don't see that often. You usually hear the young people or us in our 40s and 50s, and we're doing what you don't normally see 70 and 80 year olds, literally their lives changed right before them and collapse time. That's also something I think Dr. Winters needs to be acknowledged for.
Can I add one thing to that too, Rev?
Please.
You talked about everybody bringing, you know, the thing that was interesting to me was not only everybody coming and bringing what they had to the table, but bringing their passions. This would have been a very different endeavor if we all had to research, you know, pygmy anthropology or something like that, and we're left to our own devices to try to extrapolate right. how to fold that into what our interests and what was on our heart and what creator was speaking to us. But the fact that everybody was able to bring their passion to it and what their love, their area of interest was, and to expand on that,
Great point. That
was amazing to me, because not only could I see where their passions were and where they were headed with it, but it also reflected on my passions, and it also fed into different areas of what my interests were. This person's working in psychology, this person's working in genetics, this person's working in reproductive health. All and my vision is now expanding as well.
Yes,
so that was the most amazing thing to me, because one of the things that's kept me away from higher merit scholarship is the uniformity of it. I'm not interested in studying Columbus or any of these other things the way you want me to study them, to just regurgitate, you know, your perception of them.
Right.
And that freedom, that freedom was again, synergistic. It was exponential how it changed my experience and changed the collective experience. So it was special. It is special.
It absolutely is. Sister Sharnice is out there in the audience with us, and we love her to pieces. Can't wait to see her again. She says, count me in the next class. I'm so looking forward to starting it. And I mean, this is the impact that you've made, Baba, around the world, literally, and all ages, all levels of academia, or lack thereof. What I love also about this is that, you know, someone coming from and fighting through illiteracy, you could have a sixth grade education, seventh grade education, and you can do this. And you teach at that at a level that nobody feels intimidated, nobody feels less than, everybody feels equal, everybody feels, and you also you have this infectious disease of hope. You instill in us that there's nothing we can't do. And I am probably the most cynical, jaded person in the entire group because of all the stuff that I've gone through. You gave me hope, bro. When you say, man, listen, it's you know, and I'm a metaphysician. I'm supposed to know this stuff. But you're like, no, it's in the Akashic records. We have the genetic memory. We are the gods. We are the kings and the queens. All of that knowledge is conserved. And you have access to download it. And when you kept saying that, I'm like, you know what? He's right. He's absolutely right. And so why am I fearing and getting in my own way? It's get out of your way, fam. And as I say all the time, in order to acquire something that you've never had, you must become someone you've never been. Become that one you've never been. Take that shot and look at the manifestation. Look at what B-Man Ra is doing. B-Man Ra is writing stuff that Dr. Charles is reading. Come on, fam. We never saw that coming. You don't understand the level of containment that we have to have on this man after this show. We got to lock this brother up. We got to have a talk, you know.
Yesterday's price is not today's price.
Exactly. No question. No question. I don't even know if I can have him as my deacon anymore, because, you know, I don't know if I can afford him. You know what I'm saying? I don't know.
I want the family to know that it was supposed to have been 8 or 9 other people on the show, but we don't know what happened.
Right. Well, we'll get them back. They're a little scared, but but that's part of what you do, is to stretch. Stretch is going to be different. Right. But we're all stretched, and we're never the same again. And we're better for it as a result of that stretch. So
go
ahead.
Excuse me. You did remind me of one of the things that made me feel very comfortable with the class. Because, you know, I write metaphysical things. Right. So I'm thinking, oh, you know, this is research. It got to be historical. And I remember in one class, I said something about melanin. And Dr. Winters went in on melanin like I had never heard it before. Like, I was like, wait a minute. He need to do a show on melanin.
I know.
What he was talking about
was
what I was looking at. And I felt very comfortable with, oh, wow. So when you write metaphysical things, you can have that kind of research. Because one of the things, I had a book that I met someone who was like a Harvard scholar, you know, and we were talking about things that happened to Black people in America or whatever. And so I passed them one of my books. But of course, my book was not really acceptable because, you know, I'm not from, I don't, you know, I have an MBA. I don't have a PhD, you know. So, and I don't write in that manner. You know, but the information is there, but I don't have the research. And so when I mentioned melanin and Dr. Winters went in on it metaphysically, you know, I said, oh, wait a minute now. I'm going to have to go back and look at, you know, what I have previously written and put that level of research in, because I wanted to say that for the people who are going to be going into this next class, if you are a metaphysician, this class is for you as well.
Real talk.
You can learn how to put it out there where you don't get, what's that label they give you, Afrocentric, you know, and then they dismiss everything you say, even though it is, you know, it's true, but you just don't have that, the proper data behind it. So that just triggered something when you said that.
I appreciate that. That was a great trigger. That was really good stuff. You're absolutely right. Yeah, and Dr. Charles, I think that's what our takeaway from today is, this is the blueprint. You know, a lot of us have become jaded of just watching some, and, you know, I've had them all on my platform, but after a point in time, you're tired of watching the same program over and over again, you know, or hearing the same lectures, and we're always referring to the same books. And there's nothing new. There's no new research. There's nothing new to talk about. And Dr. Winters, to this day, I'll probably never know. I don't know how he produces a 20, 30 page special report every week of new research. I mean, that's not a human. That's just somebody else. That's a pharaoh that's just come back as Dr. Clyde Winters, I think. That's insane to me. You know, and it's been 30 some odd weeks now that he's been keeping this pace of research up. And so he can understand why me and Billy were sitting up, you know, all my hair went from my head to my face. My hair fell out and everything. Because we were just terrified. We were like, man, we can't mess this up. This guy is real deal, and he's serious about it, and he's serious about making giants. And we're sitting up looking at each other, and I'm like, I don't know. Let's figure this out. But this is something that the
family. You thought I was lying.
No, I didn't think you were lying. No, not at all. No, that's the problem. I didn't think you were lying. That's the problem. That was the problem. I know a bunch of people who put 100 on 10 and talk a lot of ish and can't deliver. I've seen you deliver. So we already knew that what you were saying was correct. And if we could just have a moment of his fingertip, like a fingernail, a DNA sample that we could incorporate into our lives, that we would be better off.
The biggest thing for us, Dr. Winters, is as busy as we are, we knew that there was no way that we were going to be able to do this and not put the time in.
Exactly.
And that meant, you know, that's working a 10-hour day and then coming back and putting in another 6-7 hours. And then actually, I shouldn't say it over there, playing hooky for work so that I could work on my paper. Because I knew that the time had to be put in. There's no way that you're going to come in here and just, you know.
Yeah.
You just can't.
Well, that's a good point, B.
You can't half-ass it. You got to come in.
Yeah.
You got to bring it. you know,
we've been joining webinars and QNARs and all of these different kind of NARs to deal with, and we're entertained and we do learn, but it's not experiential. It's not transformational. That's the difference. This one, you have to dig in. You have to take a deep dive and you have to do the work. And the beauty of that is having a group to be able to do it with and study with. But it takes you to a completely different level. So a lot of the fam, I don't think, are used to this level of virtual scholarship because it's never been done really before. I mean, think about it. Who's teaching advanced research? Nobody in our group, in our class, this is it. So, Dr.
Philippe, it was
Borashadi?
It was no Saturdays. It was no Sundays. It was no afternoons. The family didn't see me. They was like,
right. I told McQueen, I said, baby, I'm in class. Yeah. This is going to be a little different because I need my time. You know, so, not like I didn't need it before because I'm running every doggone thing, but now this one here, this is like university, and I took it as such. So even though I didn't have to physically get up, get in the car, drive somewhere, I took it as such. Like, okay, I can't fail my class. I gotta show up. I gotta do the work. And even though there's no fail situation in this class, but even if I do fall short, I'm still falling high. I'm falling higher than I left when I started. So there's a no lose situation. And I hope I'm pronouncing her name right. Dr. Borashadi, she says, how do I join your group of scholars, PhD in Africana studies with emphasis on anthropology at Temple U? Wow, goddess. Well, there's a link below in the chat, not in the chat, but there's a link in the description where you can become a part of the next round. And we would love to have you as part of our group. And we would love for you to reach out. Send me an email, revshock@gmail.com, revshock@gmail.com. And we will get you in. But this is what it's about. This is what it looks like. The folks out there that's watching, that's feeling this and seeing it, they know the real deal. You can't attract a Clyde Winters and a Dr. Marie Charles without some real deal here, because these cats, they don't play, especially Dr. Charles. I can look at Dr. Charles and tell she done cussed out a few people in her lifetime. And they might have enjoyed it. I don't know, but you know, they might have liked it. But I'm just saying, you know, I haven't been fortunate enough to be on that list.
I don't think she cussed.
She ain't playing, is what I'm saying. These people are serious people. These they ain't playing.
Dr. Charles, defend yourself.
Yeah, defend yourself, Dr. Charles. But I'm just looking at the goddesses here. These are first frequency goddesses. This is what they look like. This is what first frequency amas look like, fam. You don't play with these sisters. These are real queens. These are real deals. These are leaders. These are Maathian leaders. And you got to come correct, bro, because they will put you in check and make you like it. I mean, it was just amazing. what they can do. You know how our sisters are.
Their passion will run you over.
Oh, yeah. Totally.
Passion will run you over. If you're not careful, I have to deal with that. I'm going to have some fun. I have to deal with Sister Ma'at, so I know what she'll do to you. I've had to deal with Sister Baquette on a one-on-one. I know that she'll shred your paper. So
she'll tear it up.
Got to come, you know, your stuff got to be right. And your ego, you got to drop it at the door. Because if you, completely. You know, you be like Rev, you're going to leave. Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Stop telling on him.
That's just wrong in so many levels. I'm just, you know what?
You know,
I'm tired
of
being the leader of this damn group. I'm dying. I retire. What did I say? I'm stepping down from my post.
You can't do that.
I cannot, Dr.
But you know, you know, please. just going back onto that, and the idea of coming and being very serious and having the fire with the research, I have to say that in those arenas, those white spaces, that I had to be part of in getting my doctorate, I had to learn how to silence some of that passion and that power, yes, and that energy, because I knew it would have, once I got past the other side and I got the qualifications and the credentials, that it would come out on my terms. But this is what we have to do, particularly as Black researchers and females, that we have to kind of suppress a lot of our power, mm-hmm, particularly in some of the spaces that we occupy. So mm-hmm, I understand how to turn that on and turn it off in particular spaces. It's just part of the toolkit, isn't it? It's what we have to do.
Absolutely.
It's serious. Absolutely. This is very serious, and it's, yes, very powerful, and it intimidates a lot of people.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
You know?
Yes.
So having
on
to
all levels.
Yeah, and having to sanitize, dilute certain messages with certain groups of people. Mm-hmm. We learn to do that, but mm-hmm, my work, my research, my publications, no holds barred. I go, mm-hmm, and the story is told truthfully. But I'm very aware. It's quite draining. It can be very draining.
Would you consider it to be almost like a academic code switching that's forced upon you?
Yeah, that's it. You nailed it. The code switching. Absolutely. It's exhausting. Yeah. It's absolutely exhausting.
Yeah.
But this is what we have to do. I don't waste my time. Yeah. I don't waste my time and energy in certain circles, because that just depletes me. And they're not listening, mm-hmm, anyway. They're not listening.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, sure.
But over the years, I was the expert on a lot of different things, like Islam and China, all type of things. And I would go to these international conferences, and they were saying, where's Dr. Winters? I didn't have my PhD at that time. Where's Dr. Winters? And then they would be so shocked to see a brother from Chicago being an expert on Islam and China, or being an expert on different things. But see, what I found is that since I went to school with, you know, it's different when you go to an HBC, you're only around Black people. But I went to the University of Illinois, mainly white people, and I saw them fail. And when you're around white people and you see them fail and you see you can be successful, it gives you a certain type of attitude. And I used to enjoy going to conferences and being a presenter and being able, in a sense, to just talk about what I knew. And see, that's the most important thing, is sharing the knowledge. And I'm so hopeful that the Dirty 30 is going to keep the path going. It's going to take their knowledge and spread it and produce even more knowledge and get other people. See, we went through a dark ages. We went through a dark ages. After the year 2000, 1999, all the main people started dying off. Amos Wilson, Ira Carruthers, Anderson, all those people started dying off, and we went to a dark age. At the same time, we had the crack epidemic. And so then everybody talked about who they studied under. But the only problem was, they're talking about they studied under John Henry Clark, but they wasn't carrying on his work. So that's the thing that made me sad, is that you have all these people talking about who they studied under, but they didn't carry on their work. But I knew one of the reasons they couldn't carry on their work is they didn't have the tools. And I'm so happy that you guys allowed me to share with you the tools. You see, I'm, as I tell anybody, I'm a freak. I am a freak. I went to a white university, and I came out loving myself and my people. And see, you're not supposed to go to a university and come out being B1. You're not supposed to come out being Black first. You're not supposed to love your people or yourself. And see, that's why, you know, look at this. We got Black archaeologists in the United States digging up slave cemeteries. What the hell? Mm-hmm. You went to school for eight, nine, 10 years. And you're doing research in a slave cemetery. You should be ashamed of yourself, and you're proud of that. But see, that's the whole way that we are. And see, I want to see people who are bold. People don't understand. You know, Richard Wright, he didn't go to university to learn how to write. Jay Rogers, John Jackson, Drusilla Dungey. These men and women, they wanted to just tell a story. I'm going to tell you out there. You don't have to believe me. But if you had a good sixth or eighth grade English teacher, you can write a book. Because think back when you were in high school, all you did was read literature. All you did was read stories in literature. That's what I remember studying. They never taught us any rhetoric or anything like that. They just mainly taught us literature, world literature for 4 years. 4 years of English was world literature. You only learn how to write in elementary school in America. I don't know about over there or not in Britain. But the point is this, is that I enjoy the fact that you guys are going to make a difference. You're going to ignite the world. We're going to come out of this dark ages, come out of this dark ages and see. That's what I liked about Professor Childs. Professor Childs has come out and she's finally brought to the public that Black people in Britain, you do have a history. You are at home. You know, and like always like to use what Sister Shanice said. What does Sister Shanice say? If you build a house, if you lived in a house, no matter if somebody takes the house away from you, that house is yours. The islands in the United Kingdom, those are Black islands, but we had to move away from it. And we had to move away from this whole idea. And even a lot of people over there, when they talk about the history of Black people in Britain, they always go back to slavery. That's a lie. That's what made me feel so excited when I saw Dr. Childs' work. See, because Dr. Childs is making a difference.
Well, it's mind-blowing what Dr. Childs has uncovered.
Oh, yes.
Mind-blowing.
Oh, it blows my mind. And the thing is, this is just to be able to connect those prehistoric things from Africa with Europe. It is so exciting. And this whole thing about the Vikings. When I said the Vikings was Black back in the early 2000s, people called me a lie. But now, Dr. Childs, Marie, you had brought it
up. She brought it out, man.
She had brought it out. And it's,
you know what I love about Dr. Marie Childs' work and research also? And you spoke to this too, Dr. Winters. Most of the Afrocentric scholarship and community is focused on Kemet or Egypt, which is fantastic. Don't get me wrong. But and we always talk about we populated the entire planet, but nobody's researching those origins. Where were we? Where were we? How did we get there? What did we leave behind? What were the facts of the art or the artifacts, as we talk about? Dr. Marie Childs, when she found the Dogon in Ireland, just be with that for a moment. Just be with the Dogon in Ireland. Because we think Dogon, we automatically isolate and say that's Kemet, right? You know, Dogon couldn't be anywhere. That's a Kemetic thing. No, Dogon was in Ireland. Ireland.
That's why.
With Bono and U2 singing songs. I'm just saying they were in Ireland. You understand what I'm saying? This is different. This is a whole other level of scholarship.
That's why Dr. Winter's introduction in the Viking issue of the magazine is so very pivotal, because he's talking about the Hausa, the Fulani, the Yoruba, these West African groups that start to move and migrate into the British Isles. That's why that introduction is so very, very important. And this is what we're doing as a group. We are slowly putting these pieces back into a whole puzzle. I see it as the, you know, those little snow globes? Shake them. That's what they've done to our history. And we are taking those snowflakes, each of them, and putting it back together so that we have a complete narrative. That's why that introduction in issue 7 on the Black Vikings by Dr. Winters is so very, very important. I'm also writing right now the Dogon in Scotland.
Just stop it. You just walk away, Dr. Charles. Come on.
Really? It's coming. You'll see it. Oh, gosh. You'll see it. And the front cover that I have unearthed is approximately 2,000 years old. And he has a full afro, thick lips, and a broad nose. It's 2,000 years old.
You're making me jealous. I don't have any hair.
Oh, well, sounds that's like you I look feel. Like me.
He does, actually. He does.
You're giving Billy really, too much fuel now. I'm just letting you know he's going to move his family.
Don't hate the game, Rev. Don't hate the game.
He's going to move. He's going to go with the Dogon. He's going to be in Ireland and Scotland. He's moving his entire family down there.
Please let Dr. Charles speak.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So, B-Man, you will recognize yourself when you get this issue of the magazine because you are on the front cover. But, you know, sometimes I think people will say, well, why did you do the last issue? And it was all about Eastern Europe and Russia. Mm-hmm. You see, there is a method in the madness, or the madness in the method, because I've now discovered that in Scotland, the Chaldeans or the Kuldis were in Scotland, but they also had kinship in Russia. And I'm going to write about that.
Wow.
So they have restricted our geographical spatial understandings, and they keep us in these very artificial boundaries.
Yes, yes.
When the whole world was opened up to us. And I'm going to show this again in the next issue. I'm very excited about it.
And you know, and again, some of the Eastern Europeans, they have in mind showing those statues. See, a lot of British and American English speakers, they try to hide knowledge. They try to hide artifacts that really depict, you know, African people, black people. Because, see, they want to hide that. But you find that in Germany? Because remember, Benjamin Franklin, he didn't like the Germans, and he definitely didn't like the Soviets because he said they were swarthy. They were swarthy. In other words, he felt they were close. They were close to being black. And so and that ancestry. But again, this is a Renaissance age. This is a Renaissance age. And that you guys out there in the family living at this time, you're going to say, damn, I'm so happy I was in the 20s. Because the 20s is going to be hard. It's going to be hard maybe in terms of some of the plagues that they're going to keep bringing to try to kill themselves off. Well, anyway, but this is going to be a time when you're going to see so much that was hidden from us come out.
And absolutely. See, that's what
Dr. Charles is doing. See, those other black people over there, those other professors, you know, they tie their scarves around their neck and they try to be self-British. But they always had to refer back to the black people in Germany during the medieval age. But see, what Dr. Charles is doing is that she's situating foundational black British history in Britain. And see, that's what makes her so powerful. That's what makes it so exciting, is to have a scholar hero. And she's a new scholar hero. And see, what I want to do with this class, I'm hoping so many British people will join, because I'm getting tired of people in Britain referring to Amos Wilson. He was great. Francis, she was great. Dr. Henry Clark was great. But let's start having some black British scholars to refer to. And that's what we're going to do. That's what we're going to do with this class. We're not going to have just Dr. Charles by herself. You see, a lot of people, they've seen Dr. Charles work for years, and they ignored it. They ignored it because they didn't want to believe in themselves. And yet, they don't understand. You have to make your children know that they are welcome. You see, as Sister Janice said a little earlier, they're trying to always tell black people, go home. You are at home in Britain. You are at home. Mm-hmm. You are at home, you know? Because the point is, this is that's your land. You know, that's your land. The Anglos, absolutely, the Saxons, Normans, they came from somewhere else. See, they came from somewhere else. But you have those roots there. You have, in a sense, that sense of being. And that is the wonderfulness about Dr. Childs, is that, you know, she's hugging us. She's hugging us. She's hugging us. She's giving everybody a big hug. You see? She's giving everybody a big hug because she's letting you know we're together, you know. We're together.
Not Wakanda. Absolutely. Wakanda forever. Absolutely. Now, Dr. Winters, I know you. I think you had a presentation you were going to do for us today.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to get started. Because we're running
late. So I know. So if anybody wants to stay, you're welcome. If you can't, that's okay. You could. Thank you so much for giving us this time to just love up on Dr. Winters. And I told him our job and our goal this moment forward is to give him his roses while he's still with us. And that's what we're going to do every time we see him. So thank you, Dr. Charles. I just absolutely adore you. Thank you, Baquette. Thank you, B-Man. Thank you, High Priestess. Love you. And can't wait to see you next week with the launch of the Women's Ministry. That's going to be huge and hot. And also, of course, tomorrow I'm going to be with Dr. Ray Higgins here. We're going to be talking about some interesting things that happened to Dr. Higgins when he was during the Mike Brown killing. So we're gonna have that. So now, Dr. Winters, did you want to share your screen and run your PowerPoint and run our class for today? That started at 1 hour 36 minutes later.
Yeah.
Okay. Here we go. I think this is it.
Okay, I'm going to try to get through this. And again, as you can see, this is we're talking about we need Afrocentric researchers for our foundational Black British history. And these are some of the important things that you need to understand. Black people in Britain have a great history. You can go to my Patreon and see the slides. Twitter, Dr. Clyde Winters, at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. Clyde Winters YouTube, you can go see my videos. You know, FBA with lineage, and I'm gonna skip some of that. But it's very important to understand. B1 is acknowledging your Black African ancestry, not heritage. We got to move away from this heritage stuff. We got to move away from saying I'm part of some tribe. Got to stop saying I'm Christian, Catholic, Muslim. You got to just say we're B1 because we're Black first. And by being Black first, we connect with one another. Get away from these heritages. Love your heritage. I love the fact that I'm a foundational Black American. I love the fact that I have Choctaw heritage, but I don't give a damn. We're African first. We're Black first. We had to come from that perspective. You know, the control of knowledge is the priority of white supremacy. Yes, white supremacists, they feel that as long as they control knowledge, they control you, and they do, because they control the mind. They only ruled Africa for 60 years. What, 85? What, no, 75 years. And yet today, you can't find an English-speaking African at a university that really loves themselves and that loves their African history. They don't love their history because they've let the British control their mind. They've let the French control their minds, and that's worse. Because the domination of the university and social science curriculum is the keeper of white supremacy. To defeat white supremacy, we must dominate the production of knowledge. We must be Black first. Malibia Kelly Asante, in a research video he just did, he talked about the fact in the sense that, what could we do? He asked Antajiab, what can we do to solidify the history of Africa? And you know what Diop told him, Africa needs no defense, only advance. Africa needs no defense, only advance. Diop told this to Asante because Diop was saying is that, stop trying to talk about what we don't have. We got plenty. Move the knowledge forward, produce the knowledge. There's an old scene, you know, last week, and I want everybody to go to Sister Denise's show last week. Last week, she talked to Dr. Kaptusa. And one of the things that Dr. Kaptusa said was, he made this quote, "What happened to the Black people of Sumer?" The traveler asked the old man. "For ancient records show that the people of Sumer were Black. What happened to them?" "Ah, the old man's side. They lost their history, so they died. They died. They died. They died. We, you, have a great history, but if you don't cultivate that history, if you don't produce knowledge about that history, then your history will die and you will die. You see? And that's what's happened. We went through a dark age. And this dark age, we've had all these regurgitators talk about our history, but they haven't tried to further it. And many young people today don't even think we have a history. Many young people today, some of them are even attacking Diop because they don't know our history. They don't know our literature. Dr. Kaptusa Akiba Ankh, he was on Sister Shanice's show. You got to check this brother out. He had a deep talk on Sister Shanice's show. He's a Caribbean scholar who moved from Britain to the United States. And he made a point of it is that when he was in Britain, all they talked about is where you come from, go home. Where you come from, go home. See, that's what they told him in Britain. But he couldn't tell them the truth. And the truth was he was already at home. You know, Akiba Ankh, he made it clear that a PhD does not provide you grounding in who you are, you see? Just because you get a PhD, that don't mean nothing if you don't know who you are. What you must know is one. These are the things that Dr. Kaptusa Akiba Ankh said. Number one, you have to understand that we are the first people. Number two, we are the mothers and fathers of civilization. And number three, you have to protect your culture because it is your identity, culture, identity. Who are you? Be one, be one, be one. Black first, you see? This is what Dr. Kaptusa Akiba Ankh is trying to tell us. If you want to resurrect the African consciousness, you have to understand you're the first people. You're the mothers and fathers of civilization, and you have to protect your culture and your identity.
So why is second frequency then, Doc, so interested in our history?
That's a good question. Knowing your history will reinvigorate your mind and spirit. To Amos Wilson, he said that we should see history as psychohistory, since the aim of writing Black people out of history is to destroy any sense of intellectual or social self-esteem for African people. Yes. Yes. That's why every night, if you grow up in America, If you look at the evening news, the 10 or 11 o'clock news at night, every night they got to show you some Black person who they say committed a crime because they want to put in your mind the whole idea that you're a criminal, that you're a thief, that you're low. And see, this is why Ms. Wilson said it's psychology behind history. It's psychology behind the media. They're trying to make you forget who you are. Wilson noted that, and I quote, in the final analysis, European history's principal function is to first separate us from ourselves and separate us from the reality of the world, to separate us from the reality of our history and to separate us from its ramifications. Yes. When you don't know your history, you're lost. When you don't know your history, you don't know your potential. When you're constantly told that you're a crook, a criminal, you're dumb. This has a psychological effect on you. It has a negative effect on you. They know what they're doing, but you have to fight this. And the way you fight that is learning and knowing your history. Black history matters, yes. Black history matters. This is why both Eurocentric and so-called liberal historians, yes, your Republican, Eurocentric, your liberal historians will usually agree that Blacks lack any type of ancient history or association with Egyptian history. They tell Black British people the same thing they tell foundational Black Americans. You are descendants of slaves. Your history began with slavery. You should be happy that we brought you Christianity. When we go see our Muslim brothers, what do they say? You were nothing until Muhammad came to you, until you got Islam. But peace be Allah, peace be Allah. You have to be in the service of God. And the only way you can be in the service of God is to know who and what you are. Peace of Beulah. They agree because both groups do not believe that Blacks have an ancient history due to their absorption of consensus history. Yes. Many Black people in America, many Black people in Britain, they go along with consensus history. And consensus history is what? It's history that says that you're a nobody. Consensus history is that history that deny any role of Blacks in ancient history except as Ethiopian or Nubian slaves among the Greeks, the Romans, and Egyptians. Yes. Yes. They got many Black people that don't even believe the Egyptians were Black because they failed to know and study their history. They failed to know and study our hero researchers, J. Rogers, John Jackson, John Henry Clark, W.E.B. Du Bois. Black history matters. History situates your place in society. History tells you who you are. History promotes or discourages self-esteem. Yes, yes, yes. Look at these kids. That's what they're looking for. They're looking to you to tell them the truth. They're looking to you to tell them where to be. They're looking to you to hug them, to love them, and let them know that they exist. They're somebody. Those are our children. The foundational Black American that knows their history cultivates self-esteem and is motivated to seek success. Yes, seek success. Look, look, look. Look at what you do to a child when a child knows who he is. Think about that feeling. Think about that feeling. My wife shared her womb with me. She gave me 6 children. She gave me 5 boys and 1 girl. I thank her so much for sharing her womb with me. She didn't have to share her womb with me. My wife could have got abortions. But my wife said, hey, I'm going to share my offspring with my mind. Every man should be so happy that their woman would dare to have a child with them because they don't have to have a child with you. But children matter. Children carry on the future. Children, they need to know. Black history matters to second frequency whites. In 2021, United States election shows whites build knowledge of Black history most white inferiority. Look at them. That's all they're talking about. All the whites are talking about, oh, they feel upset because of critical race theory, which maintains that white supremacy is a feature of American society. Yes, they're against critical race theory because it says that white people are racist. It says that white people and racism is a feature of society and that no matter what you do, racism will exist. Listen, the word racism begins with the word race. When you have a race, it's competition between 2 or more people. Under white supremacy, yes, white supremacy, they have a race, but they've said that they're not going to even let you get close to winning the race. They're not going to let you be part of the race. They're going to wipe you out. Because they feel that the playing field is equal, you're going to win. We already see it in sports. With little balls or big balls. Little white balls we was running at. Look at all those Black women that's hitting that little white ball. Right, 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 right. And then those big balls. Ooh, basketball, football. Brothers run it. Maybe because they got big, I don't know. Whites feel that teaching Black history to white children
walk away, Doc.
Internal mental conflicts because white children learn Blacks do have a great history. Yes. And whites, when you study Black history, whites know that they're not superior to foundational Blacks. And they know that Blacks, in a sense, can perform and do things. They don't want their children to know that. See? But why does everyone hate Afro-American men? They hate Afro-American men because Afro-American men were the researchers that ended the European hegemony of ancient history writing, yes. Until Black men came on the scene, you don't see nobody tacking it. The only other person, the only person that's attacking the white supremacy, the white hegemony of ancient history is Sister Marie Charles. Sister Marie Charles over there in Britain. That sister is tearing down the hegemony that the white people thought they had. She's making white people understand this world is not just yours. She's making white people understand that there is such a thing as foundational Black British, and there's foundational Black British because they have a history and a great one at that. The mission of Afrocentrism is to use anthropology, history, and linguistics to ensure adherence to principles and theories related to the idea that African and world history originate on the African continent. But Africans moved outward from Africa through the human agency of Africans speaking related languages and practicing a shared culture, who found the first civilization of Africa, the Americas, Europe, and Asia. Yes, yes, yes. All the continents were Black continents. Black people were there first. You were there first, family.
So, Doc, what is the traditional view of a Black history, of a Black history in Britain?
That's a good question. The white supremacist view of Blacks in Britain is simple. Britain is, they teach that Britain is essentially a white place where Blacks only just arrived. They teach you in Britain that Black people had no history in Britain. They teach you that the colonial connections were mythicized in the very statues and monuments that surround Blacks in Britain. Yes, if you live in Britain, you see all these statues of these great white men who conquered the world, and then the colonialism, a lie. Finally, the British supremacists write that the status quo made it clear that Black Britons came from nowhere and entered Britain for no good reason. Yes, this is what they teach. They teach you that Black Britons have no history, and that's wrong. Contemporary Blacks in Britain are foundational Black Britons, yes. Yes. They are foundational Black Britons. We argue that Blacks were the foundational people of the British Isles. We argue that foundational Black British history goes back further than the coming of the Windrush generation in 1948. Yes, yes. Whenever they talk about history until very recently, oh, the Caribbeans came, ah-cha-cha, in the, after 1948, they came to rebuild a damn country. No, they was already there. But they want to push Black people history only back to 1948 when the Windrush generation came. But see, when you understand that Black people were foundational Black Britons, it acknowledges that the original history of Britain begins with Blacks entering Britain as early as 20,000 BC. Foundational Black British have been in the British Isles since 20,000 BC. When you know this, it explains that the Phoenicians were Blacks who settled Spain, Britain, and West Africa. Yes, yes. The history of foundational Black Britons didn't begin with slavery. That was only part of it. We need a foundational Black British history. The history of foundational Black British have been written basically from the perspective of non-foundational Black Britons. It's written from the perspective that foundational Black British are unwelcome guests in the UK. The major authors of this history is Peter Frager, David Olusoga, Akala, Miranda Kaufman, Onyeka Nubia, and Dr. Marie Charles. Yes, yes. Peter Frager was long time the only person who people recognize that a historian that could relate to the history of foundational Black British people. And Staying Power, the history of Black people in Britain, it was a book written by Peter Frere that is considered a definitive history of the Black present in Britain, beginning with the Roman conquest. It was first published by Pluto Press in 1984. Staying Power was reissued in 2010 in a new edition. Yes, Peter Frere, he'll say, oh, it was Black people in Britain and jump back up to slavery. Get out of here. What about those Black people in Britain? What did those Black people in the Roman period do in Britain? What contributions did those Black people during the Roman period do? They don't tell you that because they don't want you to know, because they know that in the minds of the average white person in Britain that reads that will say, oh yeah, they were in Britain, but they were slaves. That's a damn lie. Black people were already in Britain when the Romans got there. The theme of Staying Power, Friar includes both people of African and South Asian descent in his definition of Black Britain. Staying Power, the history of Black people in Britain, was written in response to the foundational Black British Black Power movement and riots of the 1980s. Staying Power is a good source of foundational Black Britons narrating acts of anti-racist resistance, but it situates foundational Black British history within the context of slavery and abolition. Foundational Black Britons have more than a history of slavery and abolition. David Olusaga, he's a modern scholar. He's written British Forgotten History, you know, Blacks in Britain. He mentions the Bengal lady, the Roman influence, and usually gives a few biographies of famous Black Britons, mainly doing slavery and abolition. David Olusoga introduced a series of short films exploring critical moments in modern Black British history, and that's good. But again, he doesn't situate the people. When David Olusoga talks about Black people, he's talking about Black people as always being in the service and servitude and waiting on white people. Stop it. Stop it. Black, foundational Black Britons were not just servants. They had agency. Then we have the untold story of the Black Tudors, you know, and this woman, she wrote a very good book about the Black Tudor period. She explains the first contact was his trading partners, and that's a good start. She talks about the Black Tudors and how many Blacks came to UK from Spain. But again, when she talks about these Black Tudors, it's still in the service of, you know, still in the context of Black people being in Britain as servants. Come on now. You know, it's really a big contradiction. She says that Blacks who were in Britain during the Tudor period came as a result of trading partners. And then she turns around and makes it look like all the Black people were servants during that time. Get out of here, liar, liar, liar. Pants on fire. They love to talk about John Blakey because they say John Blakey, he was one of the Trump. And, you know, he was a bold brother. He wanted more money. But it was more Black people in Britain than just John Blank. Then you got Akala. Akala's one of their favorite brothers here. Akala, he's made some very good, he's talked a lot about Black history. He's concerned, though, is just like most Pan-Africans, African is. He tells about Blacks in ancient Egypt, Blacks in ancient America. Like most of them, he mentions the Roman period. But he doesn't give a detailed study of that period. We need some Black British scholars to give us a detailed story about the Black Roman experience. What was those Black Romans doing there? We need that. Foundational Black Britons, their history is not just a history of service and servitude. Then they also have on the biographies of Black Britons, but sadly, these biographies of Black Britons go back to what? Slavery and abolition. Get out of here. Dr. Onyeka Nubia, now he's a cool guy. He does a little bit better. When he talks about foundational Black British historiography, he mainly likes to talk about in the context of the origins of the white British identity, Saxons versus Normans. He talks about the white British view of foundational Black British, you know. But when he talks about it, he makes it seem as though Black people were in Britain on an accidental basis, that they were solitary figures in history. He gives a little emphasis on the medieval presence. But when Dr. Onyeka Nubia talks about foundational Black Britons, he usually, in a sense, moves his story to maybe the Blacks. He only shows artwork from the Blacks in Germany, you know, where there's a lot of Black Moors. But he did, maintain the fact that we need more research on the Moors, the Saracens, the term Negro, because that's what foundational Black Britons were called. They were called Moors, Saracens, Negroes. So, but it's so much left out of foundational Black British history when you don't talk about, when you're only talking about people who are servants, when you're only talking about slavery and abolition.
So, Doc, what is the origin of the name Foundational Black Britons, or FBB?
FBB. Here she is. There's the goddess. Dr. Marie Child, she coined the name Foundational Black Britons. This queen is doing fantastic work, you see. She's a curriculum specialist. She understands the whole ideas around pedagogy, and she understands how teaching and learning must be focused on invigorating the Black child so that the Black child can know who they are and where they're going. Sister Childs, Dr. Childs is showing the connection between ancient Britannia and Africa. Yes, yes. She has a very wonderful magazine, and every family in Britain should be subscribing to her magazines. They should be buying her books, and they should have that in their home so their children can look at this. Her work needs to be in the home of every foundational Black Briton so that they can see when they go to school that there's somebody. Then when somebody tells them, why don't you go home? And they can bring out her little magazines. They see, this is what Dr. Childs said. Look at this research of Dr. Childs. She proves that I am at home. Why don't you go home? We definitely know it wasn't no Britons. We know it wasn't no Normans, Saxons, Anglos. Go home. I'm home. Dr. Marie Childs initially taught as a primary classroom teacher before moving into pedagogical research and teacher education. She has a career spanning over 30 years. You look pretty young there, lady. But anyway, she's got 30 years of research behind her. She's taught across the full range from young children to adults. Dr. Maria Childs has a doctorate in cultural studies and humanities with a special focus on curriculum writing and deconceptualized a curriculum. Dr. Childs is like Asa Hilliard, a curriculum specialist. Amos Wilson, a psychologist, but he wrote about history. And I am also an educational psychologist because we want to teach our children. And Dr. Marie Childs, she doesn't have to do this. She doesn't have to spend her time trying to make foundational Black Britons know their history, but she is. Dr. Childs published extensively in international and peer-reviewed journals, yes, and is a co-author of a trilogy of research-based books on formative teaching based on multimodalities and multiliteracies, yes. Our children can learn in Britain. No matter what they tell you, your kids aren't dumb, but they need to have parents who understand the culture. And so that when you understand the culture and you understand the history through the research of Dr. Childs, naturally your kids, yes, your children will have the foundation to make them great again. Dr. Childs is also director of the Many Faces in Teaching, MFIT organization, which gathers and publishes research-based programs to empower the learner and facilitator or teacher. Teacher, you know, they're so racist in Britain. They have, they, You go to the schools, you find very few black teachers. That's pathetic. That's pathetic. They're bringing all those Ukrainians over there to Britain so they can study at university, but don't want to dare allow foundational black Britons to study and become teachers and even have their own schools. They don't even want to have their own schools. They don't even want to have their own principals because they feel they got to keep a check on you. Just like they colonized Ghana, Nigeria, et cetera. They want to keep the whole system, the Caribbean. They want to keep the education system in Britain colonized. They don't want you to know. They don't want you to write. They don't want you to teach your children. But you can write and you can teach. But we need researchers like Dr. Charles who have that love of their people. Be one, be one, be one. Black first. Dr. Charles' goal is reframing and decolonizing the Eurocentric curriculum taught in the UK schools. Dr. Charles has developed a teaching program around the genesis of geometry, which is linked to our African, Afresh, Rahidan, Sun schools. We are the Sun people. And the origin and subsequent migrations out of Africa with a focus on the material culture that our ancestors conceived, developed, and sustained over millennia. Dr. Charles, what she does is that she's taking artifacts found in the British Isles, artifacts found in Europe, and show how these artifacts that are 2,000 years old of Black people in the British Isles relate to Black people in Mother Africa, Mama Africa. Mama Africa, that's what Sister Shanice calls it. Sister Shanice will not let you say Mother Africa. Sister Shanice calls it Mama Africa. Dr. Charles has developed a teaching method around our African origins, see? And subsequent migrations out of Africa are the first people. You are the first people with a focus on the material culture that our ancestors conceived, developed, and sustained over many millennia. MOFFIT exists to hear the agency of those who are reacting and responding in such a way that we want them to know that these structures are always contingent, tentative, provisional, and therefore subject to transformation. Yes, yes, yes. Dr. Charles doesn't have to do this, but she wants to transform the educational system so she can transform our children so they know who they were. They won't have to go to school and keep hearing people tell them to go home. Dr. Charles, make sure that your kids can say they're at home. You go home. The names of some of the foundational Black Britons that Dr. Charles is making us aware of are the Scythians. And the Scythians was just another name of the Cushites, the Celts, the Picts, the Niagara, Niger, Dubut, Scotland, the Moors. Yes, yes. They teach you that the only Black people in Britain were slaves or abolitionists. That's a damn lie. And that's what Dr. Charles is doing. Dr. Charles is letting us know our true, our authentic history, the history of the Black, foundational Black Britons. Foundational Black Britons.
So, Doc, tell us about and have we been taught a true history of Europeans in Britain?
No, they haven't. They taught us a lie. If you want to find out about the history of Blacks in Europe, get my book, Blacks in Europe, From Prehistory to Contemporary Times. Get my book, The World History of the Black Race, and especially get my book, The Manufactured Genetic Origins of the Fake Eurasian Black Migration. Well, in this book, you will find out that everything they teach you about Europeans spreading through Europe, coming from the Caucasus, it's all a lie. Those people who came from the Caucasus were Black people like you, family. Now, those people who came from the caves, that's another story. You have been taught a fake history of Europe. You see, they teach you that you don't belong in the UK. They teach you that the UK has always been a land inhabited by the whites. A lie. They teach you we're inferior to whites until they kidnap your ancestors from Mama Africa. This is a lie. Family, foundational Black, British, you are the Aboriginal people of the UK. Whites came to Europe after 1500 BC. Yes, after 1500 BC in the Mediterranean, not to Britain, not to France, not to Germany, and definitely not to Spain. Your ancestors give the UK its long history. Yes, when they're talking about the long history of the UK, it's not about the Anglos and the Saxons or the Normans. It's about you, family. It's about foundational Black Britons. That's your history. They teach you every day that they're descendants of Anglos, Saxons, and Normans. You see? But they don't want to teach you that the foundational Black Britons, they're the ones who built the UK. It was your ancestors who built the towns and then the public works and architecture of the UK. You see? In this book, The Manufactured Genetic Origins of Fake Eurasian Back Migration, it explains to you why the white supremacists don't want you to have your own schools and teach your children. They fear that foundational Black Britons will learn the truth. And when you learn the truth, you're dangerous. My book, Blacks in Europe, it will explain to you how Europe was a Black continent, a continent full of the Aboriginal history of the foundational Black Britons and other Black people. Dr. Ankh, I'm telling you, you better listen to his talk that he had with Sister Shanice. But Dr. Ankh says we have suffered white replacement. That is not a theory. Yes, that those people who went to kill those Black people in Buffalo, he said he was trying to fight the replacement theory. But what Dr. Ankh shows you is that they already had a replacement, and it's not a theory. They replace you, family. They replace you on the European continent. They replaced you in the UK. Yes, you are foundational globally. However, as Dr. Ankh has made clear, whites have tried to replace us. That is over. That is over. And that's why when we get through this research class and we get foundational Black Britons doing their research, their homework, the white man will not be able to lie anymore. They're not going to be able to tell your children, you don't have a history. Go home.
So what is the true history of foundational Black Britons or FBBs?
Let me tell you. We have to look at the real history of foundational Black Britons, not as slaves or servants, but real people with agency and purpose, beginning with Chatterman. Yes, Chatterman. The first Britons were Black. This is supported by the reconstruction of the Chatterman who lived in Britain 10,000 years ago. Chatterman is Britain's oldest complete skeleton. He belonged to this group. He lived around 10,000 years ago. See? He was Black, family. He was fat Black. But these Black people 10,000 years ago, they weren't replaced by some white people. White people didn't even exist on the planet. They were in the caves. Next, there was a spread of the Bell Beaker people. Mac White, 1947, claims that there was a close relationship between Iberia and Britain. Yes. Many other Black people left Spain and they migrated to Britain by sea. These researchers admit that Portugal and Brittany were settled by megalithic Africans who found respectively the Mugen and Tevyek sepulchres. They discussed the spread of the Bell Beaker people. Yes, you read about the Bell Beaker culture, the Bell Beaker people who went across Europe 27,000 years ago. These were Black people. They weren't white. They were Black like you, family. These researchers found limited genetic affinity between individuals from Iberian and Central Europeans today. Yes, white people today, second frequency, they don't carry the genes of the original Black people that ruled the European continent, that lived in the United Kingdom. These Neolithic black farmers were genetically similar to Neolithic Iberians dating between 3900 to 1200 BC. Yes, no whites were around. The first British farmers were replaced by farmers of the Beaker culture, and they also were black. In summary, late Neolithic Bell Beaker tradition originated in Africa and expanded from the Takwa region of Iberia to Ireland and Scandinavia between 2800 to 2700 BC. Yes. The Y chromosome carried by these people was primarily R1B1. You find this still in Etzimaria and in Spain. And many of you foundational black Britons, you carry R1B2. But they tell you you carry R1B because you had a great granddaddy who was white. That's a lie. You carry R1B because that R1 goes back to the foundational black Britons who ruled Britain, who gave Britain its ancient history. One of the greatest historians is Jay Rogers. Although Joel Augustus Rogers was largely self-trained, some of the most distinguished scholars of the 20th century have acknowledged our debt to him. Dr. William E. Du Bois, perhaps the greatest scholar in American history, wrote that no man living has revealed so many important facts about the Negro race as Rogers. You know, Jay Rogers came from the Caribbean. He came to Chicago. He wanted to go to the Art Institute. They wouldn't let him in. But this man wrote a fantastic book. You got to get his book, Sex and Race. If you want to really learn about the various royal families, you got to look at his book. He's done work on all the heraldry. He's done work on the shields. He's done work on the family crest of the people in Britain that shows they're black. You got to learn Jay Rogers. You got to study his work. If you want to write a true history of black, a foundational black Britons, you have to study Jay Rogers. You see, the white knows foundational black America, foundational black British history too. Jay Rogers published in newspapers and books. Many of his amazing facts were substantiated by subsequent writings on the topic. For example, read more about Skata of Egypt and the origins of the Scottish people at the Pharaoh's daughter, who was the mother of all Scots. Yes. Yes, Jay Rogers shows that the Scottish people trace their descent from Scotta, daughter of an Egyptian pharaoh, whose people settled in Spain and then in Ireland. Stop it, foundational black Britons. Stop feeling you don't have a history. You have a great, great, great history, but it needs more people to research it. That's why I want you guys to join my class, so you can become those new researchers. You can light the world on fire. The Phoenicians, yes, the Phoenicians. From the Levantine cities, the Phoenicians began to emerge in the 16th century BC and spread their civilization first in Britain and then into Ireland. Yes, yes. Some of these blacks left Phoenicia and they settled in Britain and Ireland. The Phoenician settlers in Britain is mined tin. Tin was an important metal of the ancients because it was needed in the making of bronze. Today, many people from the Caribbean and West Africa are moving into Britain. Some people see these migrants to the British Isles as newcomers. Although this is the case, the ancestors of many of these foundational Black Britons, FBB, were probably Phoenicians who early colonized West Africa. The Phoenicians were one of the earliest foundational black Britons. Yes, yes. Necho mission to circumnavigate Africa and Enno's voyage to West Africa makes it clear that the Phoenicians were in West Africa. Yes, you didn't know that, did you? They tell you that the Phoenicians only went to Britain, only went to Ireland, only went to North Africa, and only went to Spain. That's because they don't want you to know. Why do you think they want you to know that the Phoenicians in West Africa, the presence of Urabas in Numidia, yes, Urabas, in Numidia, would explain the migration of Yoruba merchants from Carthage to Nigeria. Yes. Yes. Many of the Phoenicians were named Yoruba, or what we say today, Yoruba. Yes. These were Phoenician tribes. Some of the other Phoenician tribes in addition to Yoruba were the Fulani. Have you ever heard that word before? Fulani? Yeah, Fulani. What about the Hausas? That sounds like the Hausas. Yes, yes, yes. The Yoruba, the Fulani, and the Hausa. They were already settling in Britain, but they came as Phoenicians. They had a different name, but they were Africans. Know your history. Whites know your history. The history of Blacks in Britain has been recorded by Gerald Massey, Godfrey Higgins, and David MacRitchie. Massey, in the Book of Beginnings, talked about the Egyptian origin of the foundational Black Britons. Yes. Gerald Massey, A Book of Beginnings. Massey explained that the Stonehenge was built by foundational Black Celtic priests called Druids. You didn't know that, did you? They always have on TV, I like to look at Doctor Who. They always have on Doctor Who some white people dancing around the monoliths at Stonehenge. And he's going to tell you, Jeremiah. The Jews was out there doing the limbo. Hey, brother, get out of here. Jewish were you, family. Foundational Black Britons. Godfrey Higgins discussed the African religious origins of the foundational Black Britons. Joe Massey wrote, they must find it hard to take truth for authority who have so long mistaken authority for truth. Authority for truth. Authority for truth. They teach you that Black people just came to the British Isles. No, that's a lie. No, that's a lie. If you've been born in Britain, you are a foundational Black Briton. That is your home. No matter if your parents came from the Caribbean or your parents came from Africa, you're a foundational Black Briton. That's your home. You're of the soil. The soil. Massey said, a great nation called Celta, of whom the Druids were the priests, spread themselves almost to earth, and are tracing their gigantic monuments from India to the extremity of Britain. Yes. Massey said the Celts were Kushites. Just a little while ago, I talked about the Kushites. Foundational Black Britons, you are a mighty people. Roman historian Tacitus in 80 AD said that, and I quote, the dark complexion and the unusually curly hair of the Silures, or Black Celts. Stop it. Stop thinking that you're not at home. Stop letting these people lie to you. Stop letting these people tell you that you need to go back somewhere else. We're already at home. Foundational Black Britons, you're at home. The first documented royalty of Europe is the Bengal Lady of Britain. Her grave indicates her high status, yes. They found bangles, and these bangles was based on material from Africa. That's why they said she had to have a trade with Africa. Look at all those white people worshiping her because they knew that she was royalty. Your first royals of Europe, your first royals of Britain were not white, not second frequency. They were Black. You know, you had to discuss the history of the Moors in the UK. The descendants of the Black Britons usually have a certain names, Douglas. Douglas means Black Swarthy, Macduff, Duns, Browns, Black, Murrian, Moor, Niger, Rorick, or Roderick. Other evidence of the Negro origin of the Black Britons was the thick lips of many Britons, according to MacRitchie's, and the Negro Moorish coat of arms. Yes, coat of arms. Those coat of arms show that so many whites in Britain really have Black ancestors. But over time, they kept marrying white until they turned white completely. Barry's Encyclopedia Heraldica note that Moor's head is a heraldic term for the head of a Black or Negro man. Negro man. Due to mixing with the invading white Europeans, the Black Europeans, like the Gypsies, Scots, and Irish, lost their dark complexions. You got to get the ancient and modern Britons. We need foundational Black Britons to go back and read these books by David McRitchie and really ferret out from those books real information about who you are, what you are, because that tells you what you can become. You are a mighty nation. Foundational Black Britons, you are a mighty, mighty people. This woman, the woman was not the last Black royal of Britain, the Bengal lady. Up to the British settlements of Britain, North America, there were many Blacks in some of these royals. Yes, these are Black royals. They don't teach you that. They teach you that, oh, you were just a servant. You always were serving us. Go home. You was a slave in the Caribbean. You was a slave here. Go home. You are already at home. He goes some more. He goes, Edith of England and Otto of the Holy Roman Empire. It was 929 AD. Look. You were not just servants. You were royalty. The original engraving of King James in the middle. King James was Black too. But they don't show that. The modern color copies of the king, they try to take away his Negro character. Look at the right. Look at the left. In the middle, you see how King James really looked. But on the right and left, you see the fake images. You've been taught a fake history. And they're going to continue to write and tell a fake history until we get Black foundational Black Britons to write their own history. Foundational Black Britons need to tell their own story. On the left, we have the original engraving. On the right, the Eurocentric reproduction of King James. It is clear in this comparison that white supremacists have rounded the face of King James and made his lips thinner. White supremacists rounded the face to make the nose longer. In doing this, white supremacists present more neck in their version of King James than is evident in the original engraving. The original engraving. In addition, in the fake reproduction, the ear is slanted to accommodate the rounding of the face. See. These people lie to you. They don't mind lying to you about your history. They want to wipe you out of history. And they've whited you out for history. They don't want you to have Black teachers. They don't want you to have Black psychologists. They don't want you to have Black writers. They don't want you to have Black historians who are really foundational Black British historians writing about their own history, telling their own story. Stop it.
So, good doctor, why do we need FBB researchers?
We need foundational Black researchers. Because we need some people to really get it going. Sister Shanice, what does she say? Sister Shanice, she says, if you build a house, the house is yours, no matter who may steal it. Yes. Yes. Sister Shanice, she teaching. Sister Shanice was telling me about how she wants to write about architecture, the East African cities, and now this architecture has been incorporated by Black people around the world. I can't wait to see that study. Sister Shanice, you got to share it with us. Dr. Onk's key to our survival. What does Dr. Onk say is the key to our survival? He says just your African identity, knowing who you need. We need foundational Black Britons who want to continue to show their African identity. But they're foundational Black foundational Black British heritage. We need researchers to write the missing pages of Black history in Britain. You see, what does Dr. Dong say? You maintain your inferiority when you don't know your history. Dr. Ang says you gotta know your history. When you know your history, then you can teach your children the truth. You'll know the truth. And do you know what? You have to study and write your history because you had to control your own narrative of your history. Because you know why? History protects your identity. You're foundational Black Britons. Britain is your home. It has always been your homeland. You are not a guest in Britain. You own Britain. Like Sister Janice said, just because somebody stole your house, which is the British Isles, does not mean it is not yours. It's still yours. We need foundational Black research to help Dr. Childs destroy the myth of Black African Caribbean inferiority in the schooling process. Dr. Childs' research destroys the myth of Black African Caribbean inferiority in the schooling process. Her research efforts aims to end the educational damage to Black children as a group who have culturally been identified in the educational literature as having negative experiences and low achievement outcomes in mainstream schooling because they learn nothing in the schools about their own history. Yes, but we need guys like you. We need new foundational Black Britons to research the history so kids will know their ancestry and their heritage. Yes, it's good to always teach that we have an African ancestry. Yes, our ancestors came from Africa, but you do have a heritage in Britain of Black achievement, Black people. You know, you gotta write new standards. You have to learn, in a sense, to teach our children in Britain to know, Black children in Britain, to know that they have to have a new sense of who they are. They have to become self-regulated students so they can produce their own learning and knowledge. You know, Professor Childs feels you need to use scaffolding to help students develop their own knowledge. Scaffolding means that you teach them the basics and let them build upon the basics to the next level and the next level and the next level. But we need foundational Black British educators. Second frequency British, they're not going to help you. They don't want any competition. You see? You have to move the curriculum away from colonialism, servitude, and slavery. That should not be the only things our children learn in school in Britain. I already touched on some of the subjects, but we need foundational Black Britons to even illuminate even more subjects. And also, and this is something very important that Dr. Childs said, is we have to use dialogic teaching methods where students ask and answer questions of their own creation. We don't talk enough about our kids. We need conversations in the schools, in the homes, about our history, the greatness of our history. We need, in a sense, to have people who know the history of the foundational Black Britons. So when their children come home from school, beaten down by white people, second frequency, see? They don't mind in the schools talking about that India has some civilization, but they try to say that our children from the Caribbean, from Africa, have no civilization. They do have a civilization. That's what based on our African ancestry, but they also have foundational Black British heritages. The Phoenicians, the Romans, the Bell Beaker cultures, we, the Moors, the Saracens, you are a mighty people, foundational Black Britons, but your kids need to know this. You see, you got to start dealing with Professor Childs' work. You got to check out her work. You got to go to Amazon.com and buy her books. You can buy my books at Amazon.com too, but you got to get her work. Everybody should know, everybody that's a Black or a foundational Black Briton should know who Professor Childs is, because she's there to fight for our children to know their history and their culture. These are some of the needed areas of Black Britannica research. We had to start looking at more than 1948. We had to look at the pre-1948 period. We had to look at the 1919 riots that took place in Britain to suppress any type of confidence that Black warriors had learned fighting in World War I. We had to go look at the 1919 riots that took place in Britain. We need more research on that. We need real research on the Black Power movement written from the perspective of Black foundational Black Britons. We need foundational Black Britons to be able to talk to those people, find out what the Black Power movement was really about. Stop waiting for white people to tell you your history. We need more research on the prehistoric period of FBB, the Phoenician period, the Celt period, the Roman period, the medieval period, and yes, even the Viking period. Yes. Dr. Childs has shown that the Vikings were Black too. The Moorish period. You. Foundational Black Britons, there's so much in your history that we need more research on.
So lastly, what is the Afrocentric Research Course, beloved?
Okay, the Afrocentric Research Course is a course, is a 15-week course that where foundational Black Britons and anybody else who want to write on Afrocentric history will learn how to do research of Black people and be able to write articles, books, whatever, on the people and history and our culture, you see? I've written a book, and you can buy it from Amazon.com, called The Afrocentric Researcher. When you take this class, you'll get a digital copy of the book. You're going to get that digital copy of the book. And in addition to this, we're going to, in a sense, show you how to do research. It's very important to understand that if you can write a complete sentence, you can write articles and books about foundational Black British history and other Afrocentric history themes. All you got to do is be able to write a sentence. You don't have to go to graduate school. They just teach you that. They teach you how to go to graduate school to write history, because they're going to make sure they keep you out of graduate school. The course requirements. The course will last for 15 weeks. In the end, I want you to write a 7-page double-spaced research paper. You're going to do a PowerPoint presentation. You see? And you're going to complete 2 assigned critiques of published work. Yes. I'm going to assign 1 article for you to read, and then I want you to read another article so you can develop this whole idea of being a critical reader of the literature, a critical reader of the linguistic, historical, and other literatures. So you can see what these people are really talking about. What Maya was talking about when she said that when she was reading these new articles, now she has a different experience reading these articles on the internet. Now she knows what they're trying to say and what they're not saying. And then there's a final examination. And this final examination that you're going to use, what you're going to do is that you're going to write a proposal, and you're going to show that you can analyze data using a chi-square, a t-test or whatever. Because when you come out of this class, you're not only going to be able to do qualitative research, that means writing articles based upon history, psychology, you're going to also do quantitative research. That means that you're going to have the ability to use statistics to illuminate your historical research that you're doing. At the beginning of the class, you're going to get a syllabus. And this syllabus is going to outline what we're going to do every week in the class. And this syllabus will tell you what you need to read in the from the research text that you're going to get. It's going to tell you the slides, and it's going to tell you other materials. What we do is that we usually I do a slide presentation, and after we do the slide presentation, I answer your questions, and then we can discuss other things that you may find relevant to that topic. So we have a slide presentation, then we discuss the slides, you ask the questions, you see, and you're going to have a syllabus, and the syllabus is going to give you the schedule, you see. The first week, introduction to research. The second week, how to write a problem statement, significance of the study, hypothesis. You're going to have to write problem statements. You're going to have to write significance of the study. You're going to learn how to write hypothesis, and you're going to do this. I'm not only going to talk to you about how to do it, you're going to do it too. You're going to learn about the designs of research literature. You're going to, in a sense, learn the various review instruments, how to methods of data collection, how to evaluate research papers. Then we're going to spend one night where you're going to, in a sense, take time to really think about what you want to do your research on. Then the following week, we're going to learn how to, in a sense, look at our various review, how to review research topics, how to assess the limitations of an assumption, APA style. Then you're going to learn how to review anthropological literature and comparative historical linguistic literature. You're going to learn how to read genetic literature. You see? So you're going to learn how to read all these different forms of literature, genetic, historical, sociological, all these things. You're going to learn how to read it so you can be able to look at this literature and know what these people are talking about, and you're going to be able to reinterpret it so that all people will know that it's not a mystery out there. Then we're going to go into statistics. Then we're going to talk about how you report your findings. And then we're going to also have a grant writing session so you can learn how to write for grants. And then we're going to get a sample letter. And then you're going to, in a sense, learn how that you can promote yourself. Then over the next 3 weeks, we're going to, everybody's going to be divided into groups. And then we're going to be have a meeting each week for 3 weeks, depending on how many students in that group. And we're going to talk about your research paper, how to refine it, how to make it better. We're going to talk about your ideas. And so that means that we're going to have that in-group conversation. And also, you'll also be able, in a sense, to write me email questions. And a very important part of the program is that we're going to send you the tape of each lesson. You're going to get that. The tape of each lesson is going to come to you. See? You know, when I normally teach this, the students had to write notes. You can take notes, but you won't really have to take notes because you can look at the tape over and over again. And then the final class, people discuss their research papers and stuff like that. I really wish you guys could have seen some of the presentations that the students made this past Monday. They were so exciting, so wonderful. It was a great time. Again, you can go to my Patreon to see the slides. For those members of my Patreon, each month I give to the students an autographed copy of my book, The World History. It's an autographed copy, and you get that for being in Patreon. I pick out a student, and then I send them on a copy of the my book with my autograph. Most of my books are published and distributed by Amazon. So the only way I can do an autograph copy is to buy the book, then I sign it, then I'll send it out to those people. I'm going to announce in my Discord probably today and tomorrow the winners of the book. And everybody in my Patreon, I have a Discord where I want the people to maybe come in and be able to talk about various things they want to talk about in relation to research. Sometime I'm there. But again, in a sense, it's a way to help build the research community, a way, in a sense, that people can have an outlet where you can ask questions and find people who can answer them, or maybe I can answer them myself. So again, join my Patreon. My Patreon is where you're going to see the slides also. Twitter, you can get me at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. And then you can go to our YouTube and see my various slides.
All right, fantastic. Brother B-Man is back with us, and you have something to share on your screen for us, Brother B-Man? And your mic is off, too, by the way. It's not working, brother. And we don't have sound from you either.
Yeah, it's not working for me, Philippe.
Okay, no worries. We were going to present you a certificate. We were trying to get this. It's not like like Zoom is much easier, but StreamYard doesn't do that very well. So we'll send it to you.
Thank you.
Delivered.
I put it in your Slack and in your text if you can pull it up quick, but it is in your Slack.
Okay, fantastic. All right.
Well, hang with me, fam, in the green room as we sign off. Doc, it's been an absolute amazing journey. I'm looking forward to the part two journey with you. Family, you know what to do. We need you to like, share, and comment. But we also want to see you in class. This is something that is tried and proven. It's something that can take you to the next level if you stick to it, if you hang in there, you make the classes, make it a point to do so, and your life will change. And that's just the way it is. I appreciate all of you. Love you. Ankajab, Seneb, Dua, Dua, Ooh. We'll see.